after the meeting. So we are recording.
Excellent. Well, good evening, everybody. Welcome to the first of the Safe Water Advisory Group meetings. So an advisory group to the City Council. So thanks for joining. And there's, you know, some background. It took us a little while and quite a bit of determination from some people at this meeting to get this group formed. And we're going to talk during the meeting about, you know, reviewing the mission of why we're here and some of the work we'll get going on. But I first wanted to thank Andrea Amico and Lindsay Carmichael for working with the city and the City Council going back a couple of years on finding a way to cooperate with both elected body, city staff, and others in the community on important issues surrounding safe water, and especially these days with PFAS-related issues. So Andrea and Lindsay, thank you for seeing this through to this stage that we're at. Sent through an agenda for everybody. I'm gonna facilitate this meeting tonight, part of our agenda. By the end, we'll select some a chair or co-chairs to run things from here. But I wanted to start out with just quick introductions. If we went through everyone's full CV or background, I'm afraid the meeting would go 2 hours. So we may, if we can hold off for all of that background, I think we know much of what brought us here. But if you could, I'm going to just kind of point around the room, and you can just, if you can mention quickly what it is that brings you here and what you're looking to get out of it. And then perhaps if you've got other Portsmouth or Seacoast related water groups that you're part of, and some of you I've served with on some in town, if you could mention that. So I'm a city councilor in my second term. I've been serving on the Pease CAP for, I guess it's most of 3 years. So with, I don't know, 6 or 8 people on in this meeting. And then also this year started to sit in on the PFAS REACH conversations about some other important research being done in the region. And I know this, we as a council have been involved more in the last term, hasn't been so much this term about Coakley Landfill, but we know that that's not an issue that's gonna go away. It's an important one. So it's in many areas we look at some important topics, so I'm happy to be part of it. So Andrea, why don't we start with you?
Hey everybody, Andrea Amico. I'm a Portsmouth resident, and I became interested in PFAS back in 2014 when I found out about the contamination, and my family was, my two young older children were attending daycare at the time, and my husband was working for a company there. So quickly tried to educate myself, co-founded a community action group called Testing for Peas with two other moms, and then also served on the first CAB with a community advisory board put in place by Mayor Lister. That dissolved at the end of 2015, and then I've been on the CAP with Cliff and many other people with ATSDR. I'm the co-chair of the RAB with the Air Force. And I also am a leader in the National PFAS Contamination Coalition, which is a group of leaders all across the country dealing with the same issue. And we meet regularly to talk about the different challenges and goals that we have collectively as a group. So really excited for this meeting to be together, be here tonight, and finally have this come together as a way to talk at the city level about things that we can do regarding PFAS and safe water. Thanks so much.
Excellent. Thank you. Lindsay Carmichael, if you could, please.
Yeah, hi, good evening, everyone. Like Andrea, I first became involved in this issue when I learned about the fact that my son was exposed to the contaminated water when he attended daycare at Pease many years ago. I am a Portsmouth resident. My professional background is in environmental health and environmental public health. I also serve on the Pease CAP. I'm involved in a couple of other PFAS related things, serve on the Pease Air National Guard working group, and I'm on the PFAS REACH advisory board that for the study Laurel's running. Looking forward to collaborating with all of you to ensure the safety of our water.
Thank you, Lindsay. Yeah, we're fortunate to have a very informed community members. So round it out with a couple of others. Katri Helmut, thanks for joining the group.
Hi, everyone. I'm Katri. I live in Portsmouth with my family, including two kids in the Portsmouth school system. I'm naturally interested in the topic because I have a background in natural resource management and water quality. And I've known Lindsay since our undergraduate days at University of Vermont. And so we've met periodically over the years, and usually our conversations are about water. Locally, I serve on the board of the Conservation Law Foundation for the state of New Hampshire and am active on an advocacy level with those folks, as well as some other areas. And I'm happy to be here.
Thank you very much. Rich DiPentima.
Hi guys. I'm a retired public health guy. I spent a little over 30 years doing public health. I was appointed as chair of the CAB by Mayor Lister in 2015. Also was on active duty at Pease Air Force Base from 1981 to 84 and with the Air National Guard from 84 to 96. So I'm not only a scientist involved in this, I'm also a victim of the contamination at Pease. And I did participate in the Pease study before it was shut down due to COVID. So looking forward for that to get going again. I'm on the CAB, on the CAP as well with ATSDR. And looking forward to this group because I think, you know, water issues go unfortunately beyond the PFAS problems. As we know what's happening in Madbury and other places, we have serious problems ahead that go beyond just PFAS. I'm also a former state representative, so I have some of that background to helpfully assist in this process.
Thanks, Rich. Appreciate that you can join. Dr. Laurel Shader, I hope I'm pronouncing your last name right.
Yeah, you got it right. Thanks, everyone. My name is Laurel Shader. I'm a research scientist at Silent Spring Institute. I've been involved up at Pease since, I think, 2015 when I first met Andrea and others from testing for Pease. I'm a technical advisor to the Pease CAP. I'm also the lead investigator for the PFAS REACH study, and we have some of our community advisors for that study here. And I'm also leading one of the seven sites within the ATSDR multi-site health study. So, and I'm here because Andrea and Lindsay invited me. So nice to see all of you.
Thank you. I'm glad you could take part. We have a number of key staff members from the city of Portsmouth. So Kim McNamara, our health officer. Kim, glad you could join us.
Sure. Kim McNamara from the Portsmouth Health Department. I'm a 20-year environmental public health person. Rich DiPentima used to be my boss in Manchester and has a wealth of knowledge, so I'm so glad to see him on this board. I also was on the original CAB that then became the CAP, the Community Assistance Panel, up until yesterday when I resigned from that. And I also sit on the RAB, or the Restoration Advisory Board, for the Air Force. And environmental health is really what the Portsmouth Public Health Department does. So I am here for all those reasons.
Excellent. Thank you. Our Deputy Director of Public Works, Brian Goetz. How could we talk about water without Brian?
Yes. hi, this is Brian. I 33 years managing and consulting water systems. Breadth of work that started in Indiana, went to Utah, and back here the last 22 years, the last eight years here at the city of Portsmouth, deputy director, and now going on almost seven from that infamous day when I took the call from DES with test results saying the Havenwell at the time exceeded the advisory level, and that well was shut down. And so far ago that it wasn't PFAS at that time, it was PFCs. So we've evolved there. We've seen regulations, continue to go down and understanding go up. And, you know, unfortunately, we are not just a sole member of a club here that, you know, is growing every day of places that, you know, have detected PFAS in their system, you know, nationwide now, from, you know, both industrial and firefighting sources. But, you know, glad to be here. I do, you know, I know there's a great panel of people here. I know it's going to land on me to answer a lot of questions because it is the public water system. So do my best to give those answers. I really, you know, hopefully, you know, we get the vaccine and we get COVID behind us. I really look forward to, you know, bringing the group out to our facilities. I think having meetings on site at both in Madbury, our big surface water treatment plant, and soon our treatment facility for PFAS at Grafton for peas. And, you know, that would be great because, you know, I may be, you know, who people recognize as a spokesperson, I suppose, for the water system, but we've got a deep bench, let's say, and you know, again, 33 years of water management and consulting, and I'm proud to say that the staff that works with me here at the city is top notch, and hopefully, you know, we can get, you know, this group out there to talk to them, see what they do, what we do behind the scenes. Al Pratt, our water supply operations manager, is on the call. He's not an official panelist, so he's behind the scenes watching, but Al is my go-to when it comes to just about anything water quality wise. And Al himself has great experience. He's got a long, you know, master's degree in environmental science and lots of past experience on source water protection. So glad to be here. And I know that was a long-winded explanation, but again, you know, to be able to educate and share with the group, you know, the broader reach of a public water system, I think is a great opportunity.
I think we'd all take you up on that offer. I think it's a great idea, Brian. So we look forward to doing that in person. Also, our fire department has a unfortunately intimate relationship with the Pease area. Russell Osgood is on the panel also. And Russell, can you hear us all right?
Sure. Yeah, I can hear you. I'm on my phone. Unfortunately, I don't have video. I'm a 25-year city employee. 15 of the years I spent at Station 3 on Pease. And of course, we, you know, have we kind of lived here 4 days a week. So we had some exposures, not only through the water, but also through firefighting foam and other things that the fire service has had over the years that has contributed to some of the issues that we're seeing, I guess I should say. I'm also on the RAB and the CAP, and I do a lot of discussion with firefighters across the country about some of the other effects. So this is a topic that's near and dear to us. We lost some folks to cancer, not that we point the fingers to any of this, but we want to stop any future issues that could come from this. And I applaud all the groups that have been working on this over the years. You guys have done a yeoman's amount of work to straighten things out and make things better. So hopefully we can do some more work here. Thanks.
Thank you, Russell. Appreciate it. And then we've got a number of elected officials. So I'll start with our new Senator, Rebecca Perkins Cuoca. Senator, thank you for joining.
Yeah, thanks guys for having me. Good to see so many of you again. Happy to be joining you as the senator covering this district. And I think this is a great way to create a connection between what the city is working on and what the state is doing. So thanks for setting this up and I look forward to working on it with you.
Thank you for joining us. One of our representatives to the House, David Muse.
I'm Dave Muse. I'm just starting my second term up in Concord. I work with a group of legislators up there, which unfortunately is going to be a smaller group in the next session, but we've all been very active in trying to legislate tougher environmental requirements for PFAS. Some of the things that we tried to get through last year and couldn't get through are things like financing for medical monitoring and things of that nature. There's a lot of work and a lot of interest in the State House. And one of the things that I would like to try to do is to bring, to essentially bring the point of view of this group and maybe even to bring some of you when we can go back up to Concord again, up to Concord to get input on and testify on some of these bills. One of the things that we found consistently is citizens, you know, people from our communities are really the gold standard when it comes to testimony up in Concord. People will not listen to me so much as a sponsor or a co-sponsor of a bill. They don't listen so much to people from the Sierra Club and the Conservation Law Foundation because they're lobbyists and they hear from them a lot. But when they see regular people taking time off from work to come up there, it really does make a huge difference. And it made a big difference in us being able to get some of that legislation passed over the last couple of years. So I think, you know, one of the things, not every solution is going to be a legislative solution, but when there are opportunities to do things on a larger scale or to make things easier for us locally by changing the law at a state level, those are definitely things I would love to get your input on.
Sounds great, David. I think you'll have takers on that kind of thing. Happy we've got representation from the school board. Hope Van Epps, thanks for joining.
Hi, everyone. I just want to give a shout out of thank you to all involved for getting this group together. I'm excited to be a part of it. I first learned about the incidents with peas and issues over there when I served with Seacoast Women's Giving Circle and had the opportunity to learn about some of the players that were advocating for changes on peas and became interested. And I've always been an advocate on many fronts and have more of a background of communication operations in the private sector. So it'd be interesting to see how that all plays together with all these heavy health hitters. But I'm really looking forward to kind of getting into this particular topic and making sure, not just from a school board perspective, that our kids are safe, but that our community is safe as well, and whatever way I can do to advocate for clean water in Portsmouth.
Thank you, Hope. And last but not least, my colleague on the council, who's not only as a newborn, but in the last 24 hours, I think it's got to be at least your third city-related Zoom call, Eglin McCaughrey.
I'm missing a rec board one that got moved and they didn't consult with me. So I'm here, guys, and I am so happy to be here serving first term on the council with my friend and colleague, Cliff. I think that my baptism through fire when it came to PFAS is when I spent a summer in a previous life with Mindy Mesmer, and I learned pretty much all about the work Coakley and understood, you know, the stakes that we have as a city, and I'm reminded of David Muse's words to earlier in the year talking about the legislature, and his reminding me that every law or every bill starts as somebody trying to solve a problem, and I look to Andrew and Lindsay and everybody that's been advocating on behalf of this. And, you know, it's the gold standard because laws are meant to help people. And so any way that we can get more community engagement, you know, more understanding around this is what I really hope to do. And I'd like to share just one personal story that when I was a kid, my grandparents lived in Bull Lake, and we'd go up there and we'd take Route 9. Every you know, seemingly every week for my parents to drop them off. And my dad would always point out the Bellamy Reservoir every single time without fail. Deg, this is, you know, Deg and Malls, this is where Portsmouth gets its water. And it kind of, it was an awe-inspiring thing because it was so far away. We had just driven 20 minutes and this is where we get our water. And to know that we're related on other communities, it only later hit me that this is something that my dad would say. We lost my dad this year, but this last snowstorm, we went up to Nippo Lake to go sledding with my daughter. And I was able for the first time to tell her, hey, Tiernan, you know, this is where Portsmouth gets its water. And, you know, it was a proud moment for me. It was met with, you know, a blank stare by Tiernan. But the understanding that we are a part of a community outside of which, you know, we rely upon safe drinking water that we don't have, you know, control over, and we, you know, we're going to need, you know, Senator Cuoca to do the work on behalf, you know, on a region basis. And I hope that this committee can be a really big part of bringing all of those voices together to really underscore the importance of this, that we got to be looking out for this for folks that might not have the time to join a Zoom meeting, you know, as much as we might. So really excited, and thanks for the opportunity. Really looking forward to this.
Thank you. I'm going to do just a quick bit of housekeeping later in the agenda, but just so everyone's clear on where we're headed. I think we're looking at tonight sort of as a kickoff, get everyone together, keep the meeting a little bit shorter, and review the charge for the upcoming year. So we're an advisory group of the city council. Those sorts of things typically sunset with a council. So what our goal is and plan is that we would exist for the upcoming year through the end of 2021 as a group. By that time during that time, we would serve an advisory role to the city council and certainly others in the community, chance to be able to review things or discuss things. And if something comes up, give that advice to the council. And by the end of that year, part of that advice would hopefully include whether a group like this should continue after 2021 and into the next term. Our goal, we know everybody on here has a lot of meetings, Zoom and otherwise. So is one meeting a quarter is our goal. Typically, I think we're gonna aim for like a 90-minute meeting, more than 60, but I keep it to 90. We're thinking like a 6:30 start, 6:30 or 7. I can reach out to everybody and see if there's different preferences. And, you know, time frame, I don't think we were talking about sort of early mid-February for our first quarter meeting. So beyond that, I'll probably send out a doodle poll. Hopefully that works for everybody. We can find a night, and maybe we can even, you know, schedule them ahead of time, but I don't know if we need to. But I think that was the sort of the overall expectation and goal. And then I think with that, why don't we just take a moment to review the mission and how we got here. So Lindsay Carmichael, you and Andrew were part of the inception of the group. Maybe if you could take a moment to review that mission and why we're here. You're on Zoom. You try not to be.
You're on mute.
Sorry. There we go. So I'm gonna just take a look at the document that Cliff circulated, which was the overview document, and I'll just basically read the short mission there so that we all are on the same page. So the mission of this group is to review and communicate the latest science on the health and environmental effects of PFAS, to monitor federal and state legislative changes, and to anticipate policy changes that could impact the city of Portsmouth. And I think I'll also just take a minute or two to talk through how it is that the group kind of came to be. So we've touched on some pieces of this, but basically in the aftermath of the work that was done to make the Pease water supply safe to drink, testing revealed that PFAS was detected in 3 of our municipal supply wells. So for a couple of years now, Andrea and I have been meeting with members of our city council. So first it was with Councillor Lazenby and former city councilor Pearson. And then more recently, the meetings have included Councillor McEachern. And I would say in a macro sense, those meetings focused on ways to ensure the ongoing safety of the city water supply. And that included reviewing the monitoring results of our city wells and discussing the health related information around PFAS exposure, keeping abreast of changes to any PFAS regulations in states across the country. So you all may know that in the absence of enforceable regulations at the federal level, states, including New Hampshire, have had to take matters into their own hands. So one of the things we wanted to focus on is just, or the one thing that we feel is important, I guess, is for the city to be able to be in a position to be proactive with regard to anticipating any regulatory changes that might come down the pike. And then also to be able to identify any opportunities for grants or other programs possibly aimed to help with remediation efforts. So with the backdrop of these discussions being rooted in potential policy actions, it became clear that it really made sense to formalize this group and expand the membership to include the various stakeholders that are here tonight. So with that, I just want to thank you all for agreeing to participate, and we look forward to doing some important work going forward.
Thank you, Lindsay. Just want to add a little bit to that from the, I guess, policy making side of things as a city councilor, where I would see and hear from yourself and Andrea and others in the community at a council meeting if there was an issue that came up, but typically your input path was public comment or an email or a phone call or a meeting. But and then in also seeing you in the context of PSCAP and other work, certainly had appreciation that there was, and even other events outside of that, that you had either helped sponsor or speak at, that there was a wealth of information and motivation on the topic. So being able to create a different input path to our city's policy to include that, I thought was as we've all discussed it, been a valuable thing to do, but make sure that we had it as rounded out as we could from city representatives and others involved. So thank you. One of the pieces that we might do as a group is create that or the policy or advice that we could convey back to the city. I think one of the first stabs at first attempts in that direction is something Andrea and Lindsay put together, that PDF document that we also circulated. And Andrea's going to talk about that. I think the goal is to have everyone have that document, absorb it, think about it, and be on our agenda at our next meeting in first quarter to see if there are changes or other edits to make before we consider formalizing it as something from this group. So Andrew, you wanna speak to that?
Sure, thank you very much. As Cliff said, he did send over a document called the Portsmouth Safe Water Advisory Group Overview Document. Lindsay and I drafted this, and I know Brian made some comments that were incorporated into it as well. Our hope is that all of you will also take a look at it and send us any feedback. Our thought with creating this document was just to be a starting point for all of us. And one of the things we wanted was for it to be pretty simple. We didn't want it to be, 20, 30 pages long. We just wanted to give everyone a high level overview. So everyone joining this group, we're all on the same page. We're all starting with the same baseline facts and then to build off of this. And also we wanted to make it digestible to folks in the community who are like, hey, what's this SWAG group? What are they about? It would be a way for them to read a couple pages to just get a general flavor of what we're doing here and why we're even meeting and why we care about this. Like I said, we won't go into the document in detail. I know Cliff sent it over. And we really want everyone to take a look at it and just give us any feedback so we can discuss it on the next call. And ultimately, we'd like to put it up on the city website. So Cliff was wonderful to talk to the assistant city manager and get a SWAG website for us. And so where we can post the links to these meetings, we can post this document for people to see and any other supporting documents or work that we may do as a group. And I think that's really it. So if anyone has any questions about this starting document, please let us know. But we'd love any feedback that you have for the next meeting.
Thank you. Yeah. I think beyond the community and having it on the website, I would also expect or would hope that we would report this back to the city council also. And so obviously I know we're an advisory group to the council, but I could see we work on a document like this. There's, everyone on the council, I think, would benefit from the kind of document that, that you have there. So it, it doesn't have to be a major presentation, but it can be information back to the council. So as you read it, have that in mind, that that's something that, that we anticipate wanting to adopt. And hopefully everyone got the invite to the Google Drive folder. So that's, if that didn't work for you, if you have a different Gmail sort of situation you use for Google Drive, just send me a request. But in addition to this document, there's a wealth of other information. So Brian Goetz put in a great deal of other current, all pretty current information, Brian, right? And then some background on the Tolan landfill also.
Yes.
So there's a lot of good information in that drive. So everyone, you should have access to it. In terms of the document Andrea referenced, I think you can certainly email comments or, you know, bring the comments. Ideally, I think if we can show up at the next meeting with, you know, a draft that incorporates comments rather than doing too much editing on the fly, that would be ideal. So I think really if you can send those comments to Andrea or myself, but then we can try and work those in and have a productive conversation next time. Anything else on that, Andrea?
Nope.
Okay.
I noticed Rich had his hand up.
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't see that. Rich?
Oh, yeah. I just wanted to point out that one of the, I think, the key elements of this group, and I think we all realize it and it's all implied, is the monitoring of the ongoing research that's being done across the nation and actually across the globe on the PFAS issue. The science is evolving, it's changing as more and more folks are getting involved in it. So I think it's beholding on us to monitor the research and any new studies that are being published so we can bring the most relevant and most current science to the table as we discuss this issue.
Great point. Thank you. Anyone else have a question? I didn't notice hands before. Okay.
Cliff?
Yes.
I just wanted to mention at some point, perhaps we can talk about, and maybe this document will talk about that, if we are including other aspects of water, because I had a couple of community members who are interested in the group ask me, well, are you focusing solely on PFAS or will you be talking potentially about any other water issues? At some point we can chat about that.
Yeah, no, I think that's a great question. I thought of the similar angle myself, and then even on the topics of PFAS, there's various avenues we could take. So really, I think moving forward, you know, and this will be a pretty good segue into our next piece, but, you know, what we bring up in these meetings is up to all of us. And so if there are specific topics you're interested in, you can bring it up either in a meeting or send an email to the chair or co-chairs. So we should elect a chair or co-chair pretty soon. Before we do that, Kim, what would you had a comment?
Yes, thank you. Well, I think a couple of the overarching issues that we're dealing with PFAS and with other issues actually need some action on a federal level. So is this group going to solely be advisory to the local city council, or will this group possibly also take a larger step to some of the federal issues that we're concerned with?
Good question. Daglin, you have a thoughts on that?
Yeah, well, I think that David called upon it earlier, and this kind of leads a little bit into the you know, discussion on chairs or co-chairs. But I think that, well, I would love just to have as much information as a counselor on this and how we can do best as a counselor. I think that, you know, all action that's taken on a federal level usually comes back to, you know, a single person being affected, understanding and bringing more people into that. So I hope that a goal of this would to be a spokesperson for the issues that we face uniquely in Portsmouth because of our proximity to Pease, and the federal involvement there. I think it lends itself to our federal delegation hearing from this group through spokesperson or people around that. And I wouldn't want to limit it just to the city council, because I don't think that, you know, I would love if the council could wave a wand and with our property tax base solve all the problems that we've kind of inherited from the feds here, but we're probably going to need some federal money in this, and we're going to, you know, likely need some state money in this. So I think to view this group as solely representing or kind of reporting back to the council is doesn't understand the total scope of the issue here. And that's for, you know, decades, the feds have not realized this problem, you know, and as it's come to light, I think it's a responsibility on them to act, and it's a responsibility on this group, I think, to bring that to light. But that's one person's opinion on this group. But
I think from an official capacity, as we are a advisory group from the Portsmouth City Council, I think to for us to represent Portsmouth outside of the city would be appropriate to be running that by the city council before we do so. But I think that probably makes sense to everybody. Certainly to your point, Kim, the changes are going to need to have help and impact outside. And we've had extraordinary help from Senator Shaheen, especially with Pease. But I think from a format standpoint, and we have some of our important state legislators with us for similar reason at this level. But I think the path would simply be, if we're going to go there, that we recommend something to the council, and then perhaps we could take it from there. Hope.
So I would just note off Khatri's question regarding of where we are going to focus. Currently, as the mission is written, it is focusing specifically on PFAS. So I would just say, not just from a communication standpoint, if we're not going to just focus on that, obviously we need to broaden the mission from a communication standpoint in our documentation, but it would also mean we need to look at like how we're going to operate, because if we are going to expand at looking at other compounds for just clean water in our community and not for this one segment of clean water in our community, then that certainly changes how we operate in looking at legislation and policy around all clean water. So it's just, I'm not really sure how the mission came about, but it's just something to consider as we're thinking about that.
Good point.
I would say that we're the Safe Water Drinking Advisory Group. Safe water goes way beyond just PFAS, and our concerns with what's happening in Madbury goes beyond PFAS. So I think we need to look at the broad spectrum of potential contaminants that affect health involving our drinking water.
I think that fits. I think that does fit with the. I'm not sure, you know, caution or in terms of scope, that, you know, in the amount of time we have mixed with some of the urgency around PFAS and how much there is, that can certainly take quite a bit of attention and time on its own. But I think the point is well taken. And I think from our standpoint, even in the name of the advisory group, was intentional, that it was safe water. Any other comments? Andrew, did you have another comment?
I just want to say that I think those are all excellent points. And, you know, I would actually love, one of the things that we discuss as a group are what other contaminants are there concerns about. I know 1,4-dioxane comes to mind as well. So I think these are very valid questions and points and things that we as a group should consider. What else? I mean, I think PFAS is in the front of all of our minds, just given how prevalent it is and everything that we've been dealing with, but certainly not to exclude other contaminants as well.
We also have to consider the synergistic effects of various chemicals, not just one chemical, but how those chemicals interact with each other to even make the issues of health concerns even greater.
Excellent. All right.
One thing I wanted to say too is I was able to see, kind of over the course of about 3 years, of, you know, going up to Concord, you know, virtually every day while the legislature was meeting, you know, and also going up to public hearings, there's an amazing amount of value in just basic education. This is a topic where information comes at you out of a fire hose. Scientific studies come from all over the place. There are always new, you know, just discoveries in terms of sites that are contaminated and things of that nature. There's just an incredible amount of information that comes at you. And one of the things that you really need is you need a base level of education. And one of the best things that Mindy Messmer did when she was a legislator, was she took the time not only to meet with people in her own party, but also to meet with people who naturally just would disagree with her on just about everything. And one of the things that she was actually able to do was to find some common ground. You know, with some people it was, you know, worries about cancer, it was worries about public health. With other people, it was the economic impact, you know, of having a problem like this in the state of New Hampshire. What does that do to our businesses? What does it do to our tax base? What does it do to our attractiveness of the city? And I guess the point is there are a lot of aspects to education that don't necessarily just involve scientific research and things like that. The New Hampshire Municipal Association is very active and involved when it comes to lobbying, sometimes for, sometimes against PFAS legislation. And there are reasons why they are for and against some of this legislation. I just think it's important for us to kind of understand that that there are various levels that are going on here, and that there's actually a lot of value in just every once in a while, you know, coming in front of the council. I know, Cliff, that periodically there are informational presentations that are done on Coakley, that are done on other topics, but just picking something and just increasing the level of knowledge, you know, trying to do it in a way that's simple and approachable, but just to make sure that when an issue comes along, people have a common baseline, because once you get to that common baseline, you can get people on all sides of the issue to agree on this stuff, regardless of party. In Concord, PFAS is about as close as we get to a nonpartisan issue. And that's amazing, because 3 years ago, nobody knew what PFAS was.
Yeah, those are great points, David. I could see this group being helpful for, you know, inputs in different directions on not just science and but legislation or policy or trends and things that people should be aware of, and also how we might make people aware who need to be aware. So whether it's the city council or others in the community, you know, it that process of educating people that you reference is can be challenging. So what do you educate them about, and how do you do it effectively? Kim, you had a comment?
Yeah, well, you know, over the past few years, when we as a group have been talking about a lot of these things, you know, there are public health principles that aren't in law anywhere. Precautionary principle is a big one. And, you know, we should act in a precautionary manner without waiting for the science to show us, you know, the dangers involved with different things. And that addresses things like the synergistic effects or the differing points of view between state levels of what is acceptable in drinking water for PFAS and federal. And those are kind of big arguments. You know, for those members on the RAB, we have a disagreement, some of us, with the Air Force that the standards that they're going to treat the water to are not as safe as the New Hampshire standards. So, you know, these big global issues or global principles, I think that this group could really help to put those forward in the minds of the people that need to have that and understand enough about the science to understand that we don't know what happens when one chemical interacts with another. And there are so many thousands of untested, unknown chemicals that are just created and released into our environment without knowing what the health effects are. And there are federal laws that are supposed to be addressing that aren't. So you know, I see this group as being able to actually look at those larger issues, hopefully, and raise awareness overall, whether it's in our state legislature, our city council, or, you know, to some federal groups or our federal legislators.
Kim, if I can say one thing related to that, I think one of the biggest reasons this group came to be, or one of the biggest reasons we started meeting with Cliff and Nancy Pearson, was we had initially approached the city council about considering filtering PFAS from the drinking water at the schools, because we know there's low-level PFAS in the city water, and we didn't want kids to be exposed, especially knowing we had kids in our school systems who were already exposed at Pease. We didn't want to add to that burden. And we didn't have an effective way of, you know, making that request and seeing that action through. And it was really because of that that made us realize, you know what, we need to have a more formal group. We need to convene multiple people together to review these things. Because, yeah, even if the EPA isn't saying this yet or whatnot, the science is evolving, maybe there are steps we can take that are more aggressive and more precautious to protect our community above and beyond what the EPA is currently saying, or even potentially the state of New Hampshire. So I completely agree with you and echo that and say that that's actually one of the biggest motivations that Lindsay and I started pushing for this group, to have a more formal mechanism to start those conversations, present those ideas, and really think them through as a community. So thank you for that.
It's an interesting topic. It is. All right. Well, thank you. That's good. Good conversation already. I expected that. So I want to keep us on chat for 7:30. So we do want to select a chair or co-chairs who will have a fairly simple role to facilitate the meetings and set the agendas. And then I think we would hope be part or be our spokespeople or be considered for that role. So Councilor McEachern, if you would, you have a nomination in mind.
I have two in mind, and Cliff, you've done such a great job at this meeting. It's going to be tough shoes to fill running this. So thank you, Cliff, for doing this. I would like to nominate both Andrea Amico and Brian Goetz to fill the roles as co-chairs. And if I could just say a little bit about this without diving into their CVs, because they both did such a great job of introducing themselves and what they bring to the table, what I think that they could do in terms of this meeting, not only running it, but bringing both sides. And I think what the heart of this is a Portsmouth's recognition that we want to do everything in our power to keep our drinking water safe. And so having both Brian from the city side and having Andrea from the advocacy side coming together to chair this, I think symbolically is quite important. And I think it lends a certain gravitas to our committee that we are following the science and we are doing everything we can from a city level to address this issue. And so I would offer their nomination for a vote.
Thank you, Deglan. So before I see if there are other nominations, Andrea, you accept that nomination?
I certainly do. Thank you very much.
Brian?
Certainly. I appreciate Excellent. It.
All right. That's great. All right.
Like how Councillor McEachern framed it, too, to get both sides, I guess. But I don't want to say I'm on a side, so
I don't mean it as sides. Don't talk past the
I would make one comment about SAFE, because this has come up before many times in meetings. I mean, safe water is what we all want. The only thing, and I've dealt with this, you know, my years of running drinking water systems, is it's a relative term. So, you know, what is safe, you know, for one person is not for another. I think what would be nice is amongst the group, you know, perhaps we can, you know, get more consensus on what it all means. So that'd be great.
Appreciate that. So just before
I'd like to second the nominations.
Thank you, Rich. Is there anyone else that would like to make a nomination for chairing the committee, the group? The swag, which is, I think, our best PFAS group acronym, by the way. So we have that.
Got to get swag.
It's pretty good. Yeah, that's right.
That's the goal of the chair, is to get some swag.
Right. Yeah. So anyone else?
We need a logo.
All right. So then if I don't see any other hands for nomination, then so all in favor for Andrea, Amiko, Brian Goetz to be co-chairs, please raise your hand. And that looks unanimous. I'm going to assume Russell's with us. So thank you, Andrea and Brian. It'll be yours to run with after this. And then we do very importantly need to be keeping minutes. So we would like a secretary for the group. Is there a nomination? I would like to nominate Lindsay Carmichael. She would be so kind to accept.
I am happy to accept.
All right, excellent. Will be willing to take a second on that?
I second that.
All right. And is there anyone else, any other nominees wanting to record this important information? We didn't think so. It's very important.
I assume we'll still be recording them as well, right?
Yeah. So the video will be done. We will be posting that to the city website. So that will be there, but in terms of minutes, we'll, and you know, we're not taking any actions. We don't have any power or can't spend any money. But we will just track if we do take a vote or topics and stuff. All right, so all in favor of Lindsay being our secretary, please raise your hand. And that's unanimous also. Lindsay, thank you very much. And we did want to, this has been a good trend, certainly with this council. We did a lot of previous councils, but give people a chance for a brief public comment. So not sure if we have anyone else here. I don't know that I can see. I guess I can.
We have two attendees, Jonathan Alley with the DES and
Al. Oh, and Al. Yep.
So we can
open that up. Jonathan, if you'd like to make a comment, you're welcome to. We'd like to, you know, keep it brief, but if you could just, if you do want to, please just state your name, address, affiliation.
No, I don't have any specific comments to make at this time, but thank you for letting the public attend or other folks view this.
Excellent. All right. Thank you for stopping by with us. So I think that does it. We'll take I don't think we have to motion to adjourn for this group. No, I think we can wrap up the group from here. So thank you everybody for a good first meeting. Really look forward to working with every one of you, and thank you for offering to be involved.
Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Happy holidays, everybody.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Happy holidays.
Stay safe.
Thank you.
Starting now.